Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Thanks for tuning in to the Insane Poetry Podcast. I am your host, Insane Poetry. Yes, indeed. I wanted to start this. This is my first one. I wanted to kick it off with, I could have talked about a myriad of different subjects and stuff like that, but I wanted to go with how I met Coolio. Yes, indeed, Coolio. You know the one, Coolio. Fantastic Voyage, Coolio. Gangsta's Paradise, Coolio. West Coast. Compton, Coolio. Yes, indeed. For those who don't know, he had those hits, Gangsta's Paradise movie and everything like that. And I actually met Coolio twice. I didn't meet him once. I met him twice. The first time I met him was with my boy Joe Cooley. We were living in Encino, California at the time. Encino is in a valley, San Fernando Valley in California, for those that don't know anything about the West Coast or have little, you know, or if you have some kind of knowledge of it, it's in the southern part of California, but it's actually north of Los Angeles. So in Encino, California, that's where we were staying at. So me and Joe Cooley, we decided to hit LA that night and go to a show, and Dub C was there. Shout out to Dub C. And Coolio was there actually, and briefly met Coolio at the time. That was cool, but it was just a quick meeting saying, what's up? Hey, you know, he was really interested in Joe. Yeah, he had no interest in who I was or anything like that. I don't think he had, cared anyway. So anyway, just to keep going forward. I think at the time though, I had the video with Rodney O and Joe Cooley called Get Ready to Roll going. So he might have known who I was a little bit here and there, but he was definitely not, it wasn't about me at the time. And the story moves on, you know, I said, what's up, peace and all that. But as years went by, my boy from a group called KMC, Chaotic Minds Corrupting, shout out to my man Poison Ivy, he gave me a call and he said, you know, what you doing, psycho? What you doing, man? I'm like, you know, I'm kind of like, not doing nothing, just had a baby or had a kid, had my son Brandon at the time. And I just got off work, really wasn't as motivated to do music at the time as I used to be at that point. And so he says, come to the studio, come down to Studio D I think it's Panorama City or Universal out there. So I met up with him down there and Studio D, we had some drinks, smoked. I kind of got a little perved. I wasn't tripping and stuff like that. But you know, he was there. His purpose was to get me down there so I could flip a verse for him. You know, and I mean, he wanted me to get a song for him. You know, and he was trying to get me out of my retirement, my semi emo retirement. So, and shout out to Poison Ivy because he did a good job with that. What he did was he played a bunch of beats and shit like that, right? So. And in Studio D, when you walk up in the Studio D, there's like three different studios before you get to actual the door D. There's a Studio A, I think it was a Studio C around the corner, and then there is ours in the middle, Studio D. So basically, Poison Ivy's like, you know, it was later on in the night, and he's like, man, I just want to play some beats for you, man. You know, I really want to get you on a song. And I'm like, oh, I didn't come out here for that, but, you know, let me hear what you got. Let me hear what you got. So he plays a bunch of beats, and this one beat just stuck with me. It stuck with me like this is, you got to say something to this shit. And I had wrote a verse over Jay-Z's song, the one that Anthony Hamilton flipped. I had wrote this verse over it, you know, like almost like I wrote the verse over Jay-Z's instrumental, or it wasn't an instrumental, it was his vocals over it, but I just tuned that nigga shit out and just wrote over that shit. And, you know, and it was like, I came up with this verse. And so when Poison Ivy played the track, I was like, this verse goes perfect with this beat. So I went into the studio on the real, I opened the studio door, I go into the booth, and the booth is behind a glass, and I close my eyes, black the fuck out, like for real, not black out like in black out as in a fall over and like that. I mean, black out like I knew the song, I knew the lyrics so well, it was a passion in it. And I start spitting the verse, to that shit. And before I even got done with the 16 bar, I hear a knock on the window. And, you know, and I look up, and it's Coolio. He was in the studio beside us, right? And because he know Poison Ivy like that, he just happened to dip through to come through to check him out and heard me spit in this verse over there. And he said, bro, I got a hook for that shit right now. And I'm like, oh yeah, hell yeah, nigga, what you want to do? He's, some niggas was born to live, some niggas was born to die and get high, you know? Hey, that's what it was. And he just dropped that shit on the spot, spontaneous. Dope as fuck, man. He came there to see Poison Ivy, heard me doing the verse, and just felt the hook right off the top, dropped that shit right there on the spot, you know? And that was my initial meeting with Coolio. And this is crazy because this was actually, I think it was after Fantastic Voyager. I'm not sure. And to go into Fantastic Voyage, which is crazy because one of our homeboys and producers, his name was M Boogie. M Boogie goes back a long ways with us in Southern California. Shout out to M Boogie. He actually was with my homeboy Shakespeare. They had a group together too. And Shakespeare and the Lumberjack, actually. And that's what M Boogie was going by at the time, is Lumberjack. He actually was doing music and had some contacts with some people. And he had this one contact that happened to be the manager of Coolio and or go-between or something like that. I think he was a manager, though. He was working around, I think, Loud Records or one of those type of scenarios. He had plugins. He was the plug. So basically, me and my dudes wrote a song called Mr. Swine. Me, my dude Charlie, the Pope Charlie, Thaddeus, we all had a song called Mr. Swine, and we rocked it over the Lakeside, old school Lakeside, you know, electro funk band. So we flipped that shit, and we made a song called Mr. Swine. And actually, since M Boogie was the one who produced the track, he was letting his people hear the shit, right? So he lets old dude hear the shit. And then just, I guess, 6-7 months later, maybe close to a year later, that same record ends up as a hit for Coolio. Now, I can't be mad at Coolio. Hell no. Shout out to Coolio. I'm just thinking, you know, that's just how this game works and shit like that. You know, you write a song, you let somebody hear it, and somebody's got the power to put it in somebody's hand to make it something else, turn it into something else, you know, that record's a hit. Now, I'm not saying Mr. Swine would have been a hit, but people who would have heard it, if it was at the right platform, would have understood what we were talking about way back then with the police and shit like that. But anyway, I don't want to veer off too much of a subject. That's another podcast. I just wanted to talk about how I met the one and only Coolio. Shout out to Coolio and everything like that. So I just wanted to drop in. This is my first podcast, Insane Poetry. If you like it, please tune in. I'll be doing more of these. I got a lot more stories, and I will talk to you soon. Thanks for tuning in.